Okay, Instagram is ready to go. Just waiting on Facebook. Let's see. All right. Hello, we are live again. I think this is installment, I want to say five, right? Let's see, we did T-Rex, we did Parasaurolophus, we did. Oh, Jess Wrestler's here. I worked with her at the Museum of Natural History in New York. I haven't seen her in a very long time. Jess, you should come to Maryland when the virus is over. We'd like to see you. Yeah, anyway, so we had T-Rex, Parasaurolophus, Stegosaurus, Brachiosaurus. Yep, now we're on week five. Week five, we are actually not doing a dinosaur. We decided to change things up. So we voted between pterosaurs. A lot of people confuse pterosaurs for dinosaurs, and I understand they kind of look like dinosaurs. They lived at the same time as all the big popular dinosaurs, and they're always associated with dinosaurs. Like most things don't bother to differentiate them. Like if you buy, if you go to the store and you buy like a pack of toys that say dinosaur toys, there's going to be a pterosaur in there, even though a pterosaur is not a dinosaur. But anyway, so it was between Pteranodon and Quetzalcoatlus. Let's see, is this. My Facebook video is acting very strange. I don't know if anybody else can see it, but it's like skipping. It's very weird. I hope that doesn't ruin it. I have a feeling it probably will, though, because that's the kind of luck that I have. But anyway, let's just hope it goes well. But anyway, so it was between Pteranodon and Quetzalcoatlus. Pteranodon is a really popular pterosaur. It has the big pointy crest behind its head and the big long pointy beak. But Quetzalcoatlus won between the both of those. So this is a toy of, it might as well be Quetzalcoatlus. It's technically labeled as Hatzegopteryx, which is a very close relative of Quetzalcoatlus. In fact, for a while, some people thought they were the same thing. And as it turns out, this toy is actually more similar to what we think Quetzalcoatlus look like than Hatzegopteryx. So I have no problem using this. And we're going to talk about that because Quetzalcoatlus is a very interesting pterosaur in the sense that it's popular because it was huge. It was arguably, one species of Quetzalcoatlus at least, was arguably the largest flying animal of all time with a wingspan about like 35, 36 feet. But it's also really mysterious because we actually don't have very many bones from Quetzalcoatlus at all, especially the big species. There's actually two species of Quetzalcoatlus. So the big one, Quetzalcoatlus northropi, we only have like one wing from, and that's pretty much it. So every time you see a picture of Quetzalcoatlus, it's actually mostly based on other pterosaur pieces that are just kind of filled in. But for some reason, the one that's only known from one wing is popular. It's more popular than more completely known pterosaurs. I guess because it was discovered first. I'm not sure. It's a very messy situation. But we're going to draw the most realistic looking Quetzalcoatlus that we can based on what we know. Okay. People on Facebook, is the video skipping? Because if it is, because it is for me, and if it is for you, I'm sorry. I don't know how to fix it. I'm really bad with technology. It's like my worst thing, worst subject, man. Terrible with computers. But anyway, so let's get started with our Quetzalcoatlus. So Quetzalcoatlus is a bizarre animal. This toy alone looks strange, and the real animal is actually even stranger looking than this. Okay, so I'll show you what I mean. So let's I'm gonna get my stand here. Prop this up. Let's see. Let me grab a board. Here we go. Gonna grab this and prop it up with this cardboard. Okay. All right. Let's get started. Ooh, shipped the whole basket. All right. So, Quetzalcoatlus, very strange animal. So I'm gonna do mine now. Pterosaurs, as far as we know, every pterosaur known could fly. And they're often depicted flying. This toy has it walking on the ground. And Quetzalcoatlus and the pterosaur family it belonged to, called the Asdarchids, the Asdarchidae, They were actually known for being able to walk on the ground really well. Pterosaurs, a lot of pterosaurs, were not clumsy on the ground. A lot of people imagine pterosaurs as like really good in the air, and then when they land, they're kind of clumsy and they kind of waddle around like a bat tries to walk on the ground. But that's not the case. Quetzalcoatlus and its relatives were really, really good and comfortable at walking on the ground. So I'm actually going to depict our Quetzalcoatlus walking on the ground as well, and that'll also give me an opportunity to show you what the wings looked like when they were folded up and the anatomy, because it had very strange proportions. It had the same anatomy as us, same bones in its arms and legs and hands and fingers, but they were just different sizes. That's all. So we're going to start with the head. So Quetzalcoatlus had a very long, pointed beak. And it didn't have any teeth. So I'm just going to draw like a kind of like a pointy cone shape. There you can see. Okay, that's all I'm starting with for the head. Then I'm going to do the neck. It had a long neck. And the neck wasn't very flexible. It wasn't like a snake or a swan, even. It was kind of rigid. So there's the long neck there. And then here's the weird part. It's the where it gets weirder. The body, the torso, the part where the rib cage and the pelvis was smaller than the head. So the head of this animal is actually bigger than its entire torso. In fact, the torso wasn't even half the size of this animal's head. It was about a third. Okay. So if it looks like a weird cartoon character, it's actually realistic. In fact, I don't know if you guys saw, I forget what year it was. I want to say 2012, 13. They had that movie, the Walking with Dinosaurs movie. And there were pterosaurs, as dark and pterosaurs, present in that movie. And their proportions were actually wrong, but not because they didn't do research. They actually consulted with some paleontologists who are experts on pterosaurs, and they told them what the proportions were. And the animators and the artists that worked for the movie purposefully did not follow their directions because they thought that the real thing was too strange looking and the audience wouldn't really be receptive to that, as bizarre as that sounds. So the real animal is even too weird for Hollywood, if that makes any sense to you. So the torso is very tiny. Okay. And the tail would have been very short. So here's what I have so far. There's the head, there's the neck, and there's the tiny, tiny little torso in the back there. They're very strange looking animals. All right. Let's see. Did anyone on Facebook comment about the weird skipping, or is it just me? Doesn't look like anybody's complaining about the skipping. So that's good. Someone requested if we do pterosaurs again, if we could do either Dimorphodon or Zungerypterus. And yeah, if we do pterosaurs again, we could totally put those on there. All right. Now let's get to the arms. So remember, these animals flew, and a lot of their power was in their arms and their shoulders. So they actually had really muscular arms. The shoulder, the forearm, or not the forearm, I shouldn't say, the where the biceps would be up here, this bone was quite short, relatively speaking, but it had a lot of muscle. So I'm going to draw some like big, I don't want to say lumps of muscle, but big bulky shoulders and biceps. And then here's what would be the forearm. This would be the wrist right here. This is the hand bone, the hand. Like just these bones here were elongated in pterosaurs. And then the fingers would go here. And pterosaurs had actually four fingers, but people usually only think they have three. So this toy here, you could see it has, whoop, I don't know if I both can see it, one, two, three fingers on that little hand there. But there's actually a fourth finger. The fourth finger is the rest of the wing. So this wing is supported by the finger, and then there's skin that stretches between the finger. In fact, you know what? I have two Quetzalcoatlus toys. That's how strange of a person I am. Hold on, I'll be right back. I'm gonna get you the other one. And this one is flying. This one has its wings out. Okay. And this is actually a Jurassic World toy. You can probably buy this at the store right now. But anyway, here's where the bicep is. Here's the shoulder. Here's the bicep. Here's the forearm. Okay. Here's the elbow. Elbow, forearm, wrist, hand bone, three, one, two, three fingers, fourth finger. Okay, the fourth finger is super long. Oops, sorry. The fourth finger, I'll use this hand. The fourth finger is super long. So sorry, Instagram, you probably didn't see that. So I'll do it again. Shoulders here, bicep, elbow, forearm, wrist, hand bones, one, two, three finger, fourth finger. Okay? And what they could do is they could bend when they would walk. They would bend their wrists. Okay, if they wanted to walk, kind of like this guy's doing here, but they would also bend this fourth finger up and around to be out of the way when they were on the ground, like this guy's doing. Okay. Yeah, so don't ever say dinosaur toys can't help you, or pterosaur toys, I should say. So ours is walking. So here's the hand bone, and now I'm going to draw the little fingers. Crystal, your son has good taste in toys. One, two, three claws. And then the fourth claw, or fourth finger, I should say, not claw, is going to come up to about here. Okay. The other strange thing about as-darked pterosaurs, especially Quetzalcoatlus and its relatives, closest relatives, is that the finger, that the wing, you'd think that finger, the wing finger, would be really long. And in a lot of pterosaurs, it is. Like, if we had done Pteranodon today, we would have to do a very long wing finger. But as strange as that may seem, Quetzalcoatlus did not have a very long wing. This toy is inaccurate. Okay, this wing is too short. This toy is a little better because the wing finger starts here. So it's less than half the length of the entire wing. But still, I think this could afford to be a little shorter. These animals proportionally did not have very big wings. It's weird, right? Like, you'd think if it was a big animal that was flying, it would have big wings, but they didn't. Proportionally speaking, they did not have very big wings. All right. So there's my wing finger. And then I just drew the shape of the wing and it's folded up. So imagine it like, kind of like we did with that toy. So there's the arm. Okay. And there's the hand on the bottom. There's the fourth finger that goes up, and it's folded upwards so it doesn't get in the way when it's walking around the ground. Because if otherwise, the finger would be flopping around on the ground. That's no good. Okay, so now we're going to do the legs. Now, the legs aren't going to show up all the way. So I'm going to kind of draw them behind the wing here. And the legs are very skinny. And so far we've talked about how dinosaurs, they walk on their toes. Well, pterosaurs did not walk on their toes. They were plantigrade, which is what we call when they walk on their feet, just like we do. So pterosaur legs and feet were actually very similar to our legs and feet. And they had tiny little feet, relatively tiny feet, and very skinny legs. So you see the leg is kind of like behind the wing. It's not fully visible because the wing's in the way. And as an artist, you're going to have to kind of learn how to do that. A lot of times if you're drawing animals, especially animals in realistic situations, you're going to have to learn how to draw things behind other things. And one way to do that is kind of imagine what it would look like but without actually drawing it. Sometimes if you want to, you can just draw it and then erase it later. Okay. But part of it, like the knee is not visible. It's behind the wing there. And then there would be like a piece of skin that would go from the wing to about a little bit below the knee, but so it would connect about here, but I'm not going to draw that because the wing's in the way. All right, now I'm going to draw the other arm. So the other arm is going to be a little bit more forward. So here's the elbow. Here is the forearm. Here is the hand bones. Here's one finger. The other fingers would not really be visible from this angle. And then here's that fourth. And then there's going to be some skin. And since on this arm, the wing is going to be on the outside, it got to be the same thing there. So we're actually going to see the skin from the bottom, and the wing is going to be overlapped. And then the leg is going to be almost completely behind there. Maybe I'll just draw like a little toe. That's it. And there's our Quetzalcoatlus body. What a weird animal, huh? Bizarre. Are the fingers able to be posed or more of a claw? The three fingers, the three short fingers, were pretty flexible and could grip things and had claws on them, but the fourth finger did not. It did not have a claw at the end of it. Yeah, so let's see the rest of the head here. So here's the thing, Quetzalcoatlus's skull was never found. We don't know too much about the face and the head of this animal, and even its relatives like Hatzegopteryx, we also don't have the whole skull. We only have pieces of it. That whole family that as Dachshunds are kind of mysterious in the whole head region. So there's room for some there's room for imagination when it comes to parts of the skull. So I'm going to start with what we do know, and then we're going to go from there. So based on other pterosaurs that are related, we know that Quetzalcoatlus probably had a long pointed beak with no teeth. So it probably tapered down kind of like a set of tweezers, and it got more broad towards the base. There's the top jaw, and there's the bottom jaw. And then the jawbone itself is going to come up here, but underneath the jawbone, there would have been probably a pouch of skin, its throat. So the neck itself of the living animal would have been a lot thicker than what the skeleton shows, which we know by this point from drawing our dinosaurs. And then the eye, you can put the eye in a number of different places. The skull would have ended about here, and the base of the neck would have been here. I've drawn the eye up high before. I think the more credible sources that I've seen tend to put the eye a little lower. So there's our eye, if you can see it. I'll bring it a little closer, or the eye socket. And the eye itself is going to be even smaller. So there's the actual eye. Made it quite small. I remember when our brachiosaurus lesson, a good way to convey that the animal that you're drawing is large is to depict a small eye proportion to the rest of the body. Crystal says that they ate baby dinosaurs. They might have. They almost certainly ate meat. And if they were walking around on the ground a lot, they were probably good at grabbing small animals that they found and swallowing them whole. They probably also were scavengers. They would probably eat like already dead animals that they would found, maybe acting like vultures or the big storks that you see in Africa. And yeah, they certainly, I don't see why they wouldn't have eaten a baby dinosaur. You do see them depicted eating baby dinosaurs a lot in artwork. A lot of artists like to draw them eating baby dinosaurs, I guess because it's exciting or scary. So yeah, I don't see any reason why they wouldn't be. There's no proof or fossil evidence that they explicitly were eating a baby dinosaur. We haven't found like baby dinosaur bones inside of a Quetzalcoatlus stomach or anything. But yeah, absolutely, they very well could have been eating baby dinosaurs. Only the really small ones, though, by the way, because if you think about it, this guy is as cool as it is, and is Oh, someone asked if they hunted Compsognathus. No, they could not hunt Compsognathus. Not to say that they couldn't physically eat one if they met one, but Quetzalcoatlus lived at the very end of the Cretaceous in North America, like 68 to 66 million years ago, and Compsognathus lived during the late Jurassic in Germany. So it's not like a Quetzalcoatlus couldn't physically eat a Compsognathus, but it just couldn't because it didn't have a time machine. So, but if there was other dinosaurs around then that were like around the same size as Compsognathus, then absolutely, I'm sure it would probably go for one of those. But as I was saying, they probably would only eat stuff that they could swallow whole, when it came to little animals. And maybe they were able to grab chunks of meat off of a rotting carcass. But I find it difficult to imagine Quetzalcoatlus like going after like a bigger animal. That doesn't seem very likely to me, especially considering the fact that they run the risk of injuring themselves. If a pterosaur injures itself, it's in a lot of trouble if it can't fly, because then it runs the risk of getting eaten by like a tyrannosaurus or something. So they probably only focused on very small animals or dead carcasses. That's just my hypothesis. Maybe they didn't. The nostril would have been around here, roughly. Now, again, this head is based on educated guesswork. We don't have the full skull of a Quetzalcoatlus, if any at all. So it might have looked different from this, but based on what we know about this group of pterosaurs, this seems the most likely. Now, on the head, it probably had some kind of a crest. A lot of pterosaurs had crests on their heads. And the crests themselves can sometimes look small on the skeleton, but thanks to newer technology, some paleontologists were able to actually look really closely at those bones, the texture of those bones, as well as the surrounding area that they fossilized in on the rock. And they're able to deduct that they probably had a bigger, more elaborate crest than what we usually think. So this is the cool part. You can kind of make your Quetzalcoatlus have any kind of crest you want, because we don't really know. Maybe it had a small crest that started on the nose. Maybe it had a small crest in the back of the head. It could look like a lot of things. I'm going to have mine kind of start here on the nose, and then I'm going to have it kind of go to the back of the head and there, kind of like a helmet or something. But yours can look different from mine if you want it to. All right, now we can start working on like the textures and stuff of this guy. I'm going to take my eraser. I'm going to erase some of these extra lines that I did because there's no need for that anymore. I use them to help me sketch it out, but I don't need them anymore. In fact, they're going to get in the way when I start to color. There we go. Get some of those out of the way. Cool. So texture. So far we've done a bunch of dinosaurs, and our Tyrannosaurus had a little bit of feathers on it, but the other ones had Melanie wants to know if they hunted human-sized dinosaurs like Stygimoloch. So Quetzalcoatlus did live alongside Stygimoloch, but I don't think it could have eaten a Stygimoloch. I think Stygimoloch is too big. Quetzalcoatlus is really large. It's like tall, but it was really light and kind of fragile. And I wonder if it did threaten a Stygimoloch or a Pachycephalosaurus. I wonder if that Stygimoloch could have fought back and maybe rammed it or bitten it and injured the pterosaur. But again, I don't know. Maybe they did. But I'm skeptical about that. But anyway, so what kind of body covering did a pterosaur have? Were they scaly like some of our dinosaurs? Well, they might have had some scales on them, but we know that pterosaurs actually had what looked like fur. Biologically speaking, we found out that it's actually more like a kind of a weird feather, but they weren't birds. They weren't even dinosaurs, but they had like feather-like covering on their bodies. And they probably had this to help stay warm. Got to remember, animals that fly, especially if they fly high up in the air, need to stay insulated, even if they live in hot environments. So if you think about if you ever go up, if you ever climb like a tower, the air gets cooler the farther away from the earth that you get. So even if it was like a tropical environment or a warmer environment on the ground during the Cretaceous in North America, if this animal is flying up in the air, or especially if it was flying over large bodies of water, okay, it would have been colder up there. So it probably had some kind of a fur covering to help keep it warm. How tall was it? The biggest one kinds of these guys were about the same height as a giraffe. So imagine a giraffe that could fly. That's kind of like what these guys looked like. Yeah, so that was two people's questions I answered at the same time. So about as tall as a giraffe. They're quite tall. They weren't bulky. They weren't heavy at all. In fact, they were really, really light for their size. They had to be in order to get off the ground, but they were very tall. So yeah, so there's some fuzzy covering. You can see the fuzzy covering I drew on the neck there. Okay, and it would have had on the body too. All right, and then I'm going to outline that other hand a little bit better here. Oh, I forgot something. There's an extra bone. I almost forgot. I almost left it out. Good thing I didn't. There's an extra bone on the wrist of a pterosaur, and it sticks out. I don't know if you can see. It sticks out kind of here. There we go. Can see I drew those little, it looks like little things sticking out of their wrists there. Okay. And there would have been skin attached there, like over the elbow, and that kind of expanded the wing when they opened their wings up. You could see it. This toy has it. It's here, kind of between the elbow and the wrist, or the shoulder and the wrist. And this toy also has it. So it would be right here, this little piece of purple. This toy is good because the wing part. The skin part of the wing is purple. It's a different color than the frame of the wing, so you can see the anatomy pretty well. So this is purple here. That would have been connected by a little bone here that would have stuck out of the wrist. All right, cool. And then I'm going to put a little bit more detail on the leg. They had four toes on their feet. And some pterosaurs had webbed feet. We actually know that thanks to some tracks that they left behind. We don't really know about Quetzalcoatlus, though, but it could have. And there's our claws. All right. And what time we got? Okay, we've got about a half hour left. I think we could do something special with this picture. Let's put another Quetzalcoatlus in this picture. Let's put do two. I think we have the time. I think we can do it. The second one I want to do flying. So I'm going to have one on the ground, and then I'm going to put one in the distance in the air. All right. So this one, I'm going to start again by doing the head. Now remember, this one I'm going to draw much smaller with less detail because it's in the distance, right? And we learned that when we drew our brachiosaurus last week. So there's the neck, there's the little body. So there's the shape that I have so far. Okay, just like a little head, little neck, little body. There's the leg. This is essentially just a stick. And then the wings. Just going to be sticking out there. There's my little Quetzalcoatlus in the distance. Okay. I don't need to put too much detail on this because if I do, it's not going to look right. So, and also it's hard to draw lightly when my paper is propped up like this. So there's the tail. Okay, here's the crest on the head. Eye would be about here, the beak. There we go. There it is. Voila, flying pterosaur. I'm gonna actually extend the chest a little bit more. These guys had very big chests because they had a lot of muscles that attached there. There we go. Where's that extra line? This guy's just gonna probably extend that a little bit more too. Cool. There's our pterosaurs. It stood 4 feet tall. Oh, Pteranodon did. Yeah, about. Yeah, roughly 4 feet, depending on how it crouched down and stood up straight, because they could do a lot of this. But yeah, about. Yeah, and Quetzalcoatlus would have been much taller. Someone said, did they eat marine reptiles like Tylosaurus? So, Tylosaurus also did not live alongside Quetzalcoatlus. Tylosaurus was from like 80 something million years ago, and Quetzalcoatlus was 68 to 66. And again, Tylosaurus is like way too big for Quetzalcoatlus to eat. Tyrannosaurus is like close to 50 feet long. So I don't think there's any way Quetzalcoatlus could have taken a Tylosaurus, and a baby Tylosaurus would have been in the water. And Quetzalcoatlus doesn't appear to be a marine or ocean-going pterosaur like Pteranodon was. And again, they were separated by time. Lots of time. The pterosaur eggs, that's a good question. We do have pterosaur eggs. We don't have them from Quetzalcoatlus, though. But the ones that we do have, I believe, are oval-shaped. And the cool thing about pterosaur eggs is they're not like dinosaur eggs. They're not like hard. So dinosaur eggs and birds are dinosaurs, have hard shells on their eggs. Pterosaurs had eggs that are a little bit more like a turtle egg, so they would have had some give to them. And we know that because we can look at the fossilized eggs under a microscope and tell what their makeup would have been like and what they would have been like texture-wise in life. So even though the fossil is hard like a rock, in life we can tell what it would have been like. So these guys had like kind of squishy, soft turtle eggs. Yes, Christian says that they had a 36-foot wingspan. Yep, that's correct. Yeah, we mentioned the very beginning too, but I'm glad that you mentioned it again. Yeah, about a 36-foot wingspan. Remember, this is a very fragmentary animal, so might have had a little bit more, a little bit less, but about 36 is a solid estimate. Right. So, and again, the exact height we cannot say for sure because we only have a little bit of this animal's skeleton. But about 18 feet sounds plausible, totally within the realm of accuracy, especially if you base it off of other pterosaurs. Cool. I think we can move on to our painting. All right, so I'm going to move this board out of the way. Crud. And I'm going to put this here. I'm going to move this out of the way. It's here. Okay. This flying guy can go up here. Right. Here's my paints. Here's my paint brushes. Here's my water. And here's my rag. Cool. And here's my Quetzalcoatlus. Hatzigatrix, whatever. All right. So let's get ready to paint. Instagram, sorry, Instagram. Like, it's very hard to angle the phone without crashing all over the place, but I'll hold it up so you can see it. All right, so for Quetzalcoatlus's colors, this is a big animal. So I don't know how bright it would have been, and if it was bright, it could have been maybe on the crest. So let's do some colors. I'll show you kind of like what I did with the Parasaurolophus. Let's do some colors that might not seem like they're bright and interesting, but if you do them in a certain way, they will look really cool, especially if you know how to mix your colors. So I'm going to start off with a little bit of blue, and I'm going to mix the blue with my black. And then if you mix that with water, because these are watercolors, you'll get like a nice pretty gray color. But it'll have some blue tint to it. So it's not going to look flat like if you just like colored it in with a pencil. All right, so I'm going to start by painting the beak this pretty bluish gray color. So there we go. And then I'm going to go into the throat with the same gray. And then I'm going to go into the crest with the same gray. And I'm also going to paint around the eye with the same gray. In fact, I think I'm going to extend this all the way past the edge of the mouth, and it's going to connect into the eye. There we go. Now, so here it is. So now while the paint's still wet, I'm going to mix orange, red, to make like a red orange color, and then, so it's not too bright. Because if you make animals, like living, certain animals, too bright doesn't look so good. Certain animals look great with bright colors, but some don't to me. I'm going to make this nice, pretty, kind of burnt orange color, I'm going to call it. And I'm going to start blending that in with the blue while the blue is still wet. And I'm going to imply that the fur or the feathers on this animal's neck is like a pretty orangey, reddish, like a ginger color. And the reason why I chose to do this is because I'm inspired by another kind of animal that's alive today that also flies, but it's not related to a pterosaur, but it's still fun to do it. And that is a fruit bat. Some fruit bats have colors kind of like this, with the orangey red fur around the neck. All right. Okie dokie. All right, let's keep going. So I'm going to take this orangey color, I'm going to extend it into the shoulders a little bit. And then I'm going to go back to the bluish gray. Going to blend that on the chest. I'm going to take my bluish gray and I'm going to start filling in the rest of the body. Now be careful. Make sure you keep track of where your wing is, because sometimes when I draw pterosaurs and the wing is all folded up, I lose track of where the wing is and open space is behind the wing. There's like a little window of open space, and I'll show you when I'm done painting this wing that I've in the past accidentally painted, but I didn't mean to paint it. Wing, and then there's the foot. Right, so here's what I mean. So there's some open space right there in like the crook of the wing and also between the tail and the wing. There's a little bit of like eraser bits stuck on my paper here. So I'm going to take those off with the brush real quick to clean it up. All right, cool. And now I'm going to take that same gray and I'm going to do the other wing. There we go. Fill all that in. Great. There we go. Looking good. So there's the base colors for my Quetzalcoatlus. I'm still going to do some more colors though. Now the beak is all dry. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to take some darker, like a black, almost entirely black, a little bit of water mixed in, and I'm going to do some like markings on the face. So if you look at like some birds alive today, again, birds aren't pterosaurs. They're not the same, but they shared some things in common. They have, if the ones with long beaks, sometimes they have like markings on the beak. So I'm going to do like a ring around the beak of this animal. So some gulls have this, there's even a gull called a ring-billed gull. Okay, it lives around here in the Northeast. They're pretty widespread. So there, I did like a ring around the beak. That looks pretty cool. I'm gonna do another one. I'm gonna do one that's kind of like at the nostril, that's gonna kind of extend into the crest. Now note that the markings that I'm doing aren't like super clean lines, because they're, you know, I want them to look a little bit more natural. And also note that how I made it curve. So the curve is reflecting the fact that the beak is kind of curved on the outside of it. It's like a rounded from the side. It's not flat. It's not a piece of paper. So it's a real animal, right? Because that's what we're going to tell people that look at our paintings. All right, and then I'm going to do another marking on crest. Kind of extend into the face a little bit. And one more that's going to be kind of on the base of the crest. There we go. Maybe a little spot there. Looks cool. Maybe I'll do some more of this black marking around the eye. There we go. That looks good. There. Sometimes it's fun to just kind of think of ideas on the fly. And then I'm going to take some darker colors and I'm going to paint the tips of the wings. A lot of birds that fly, especially the ones that fly, not all birds fly, have darker tips to their feathers. Gulls are a good example of this. Next time you go to the beach or even like a parking lot, you'll see some gulls. Look at their wings. Their bodies tend to be lighter colored, but the tips of their wings tend to be dark gray or black. And that's because the chemical that makes things black in the cells called melanin actually reinforces that structure. So the tip of the wing that's often taking the most abuse, like if it's flying around, it's getting whipped around by the wind or crashing into stuff, it's probably hitting things. That could fray and become damaged over time. If there's melanin in those feathers, or in this case, in this part of the wing, it's better, it'll have a longer shelf life and it won't need to shed as often. It'll be more protected. It'll also be more protected from the sun. So, did it definitely have dark tips on the wings? No, but it's a solid guess. All right, and now I'm gonna paint the one in the background. I'm gonna try to make the background one match as best I can. Now remember, I'm not gonna go into as much detail about this background pterosaur because it's so far in the distance. If they were next, they're supposed to be the same size, these two guys. But this, since it's so far away, I'm implying that it's far away. I have to draw it smaller. There's an orange part of its neck. There we go. And keeping the chest white. Think it looks cool. Now I'm going to paint the dark tips on the wings, on the beak. There we go. There's my background pterosaur. Looking good. Okay, now it's time to do our background. So maybe we can do like Quetzalcoatlus was on like a rocky hill or maybe even a mountain. It definitely frequented like lowland areas for sure, even swamps. But because it could fly, it could get higher, maybe where other animals couldn't reach it. And that's an advantage, right? So they maybe laid their eggs up there or they just rested up there, or they knew something like a Tyrannosaurus, which did live at the same time as Quetzalcoatlus, couldn't get it. So Quetzalcoatlus lived, because a lot of people have been asking me, like, oh, could it eat this? Did it meet this animal? So Quetzalcoatlus lived at the very end of what we call the age of dinosaurs, even though dinosaurs are still alive, because birds are dinosaurs, right? So they lived at the very end of the Cretaceous period, between 68 and 66 million years ago. So Quetzalcoatlus would have been one of the animals that was killed or went extinct as a result of that meteorite hitting the Earth. And other animals that were in that community at the time, in North America specifically, which is where Quetzalcoatlus is from, southwestern, its bones were found in southwestern United States. And also, I think it went into Mexico too, from what I remember. I could be wrong about that. When it was alive, it definitely would have been able to go into what is now Mexico, that's for sure. I don't know if the bones were found there, though. But other animals that were part of that community were really popular dinosaurs that everybody knows and loves, like Tyrannosaurus Rex would have met Quetzalcoatlus. Maybe it ate Quetzalcoatlus. Maybe Quetzalcoatlus ate baby hatchling Tyrannosaurus Rex too, like someone was saying before. Triceratops also lived back then at that time and place. So Quetzalcoatlus would have seen Triceratops. It would have seen, like someone said before, Stegomalac or Pachycephalosaurus. It would have seen Edmontosaurus, or it's also called Anatosaurus or Anatotitan sometimes, which is a big duck-billed dinosaur. Ankylosaurus, which a lot of people know with the armor. So there were a lot of really popular animals at that time and place. There was also a really big sauropod, a long neck, that was around back then called Alamosaurus. Alamosaurus. It's from Texas, if you couldn't. Let's paint the eye of this guy. I'm gonna do a red eye. That looks cool. It's small, but it looks cool. Got a little red eyeball there. That's neat. Right. So We gotta let the ground dry a little bit more, but we can still do this while the ground is wet. We can put in some shading on the earth. So Quetzalcoatlus would have cast a shadow on the ground, right? So I'm gonna put a shadow underneath this animal's body. And remember, your shadow doesn't have to be perfect. In fact, since this animal's standing on some like rocks and dirt, the shadow would be kind of lumpy looking, right? Because it's cast over all these rocks and dirt. Think of a shadow like laying a blanket out or a towel, right? If you lay a towel out over some dirt, rocky terrain, the towel is going to be lumpy when it's on the ground, right? It's not like it magically becomes smooth. So same thing with a shadow. So my shadow is kind of messy and bumpy and lumpy looking. Good. It looks like it's standing on some like uneven ground, which it is supposed to be doing. If I said that I painted like dirt and rocks and then I made like a perfectly straight shadow, it wouldn't look right. So again, this is another one of those instances where like it's okay to have like a messy drawing because certain things in nature are definitely messy. Let's see if I can do some clouds. Kind of like what we do with the Brachiosaurus. So I'm gonna take a nice pretty blue and get a bigger brush for the clouds. Supposed to be maybe a clearer day in this picture. It's a sunny day here where I am. So we'll do a sunny day in our painting too. So remember a trick I told you when you want to paint clouds, you don't have to paint the whole sky blue and paint over white. It's very difficult to paint white color, especially with watercolors. In fact, it's kind of impossible to paint white over a color background with watercolors. You usually have to go and use a different kind of paint, like acrylics or something, to paint white over. And I prefer not to do that if I don't have to. So what I do is I use the color of the paper, which is white. So I'm careful not to paint over the background pterosaur here. Do my best. I think I did get a little bit of blue in there by accident, but that's okay. It's not the end of the world. There we go. And it's okay if your clouds are kind of messy looking. That's fine. That's allowed. Clouds look like all kinds of weird stuff, right? And I'm also going to take some just water on my brush, and I'm just going to like smooth out some of the tops of these clouds with the water part. There we go. Cool. That looks pretty cool. Nice and pretty. Let's keep going with that. So I'm gonna take more blue. Gotta keep replenishing the paint. Do some more blue down here. And it's okay if my clouds touch each other too. That's allowed. Clouds can look like anything you want. If you want to do different shape to your clouds, you can. Maybe you want to do like shape of a dinosaur cloud. Maybe there were clouds back then that were shaped like choo-choo trains and airplanes, even though choo-choo trains and airplanes hadn't been invented yet. Stopping a cloud by coincidentally looking like one. Okay, I'm gonna start doing the other side. So I imply that there's a cloud behind the sky. It would be kind of weird if I didn't continue the cloud on the other side of the pterosaur of the Quetzalcoatlus. So I'm gonna kind of draw the other end of this cloud, these clouds. There we go. Let's do some over here. I'll do a big one over here. Big blobby one. And no, I'm not really even being careful with my brush here. I'm just kind of making them look like squiggles or blobs. I'm allowed to be messy. Clouds are definitely allowed to be messy. Now I'm gonna go with my water, smooth out the tops. There we go. There we go, a little bit underneath the legs there. Extend that up. It's another cloud. I'll do one more pretty big one, maybe two more. Up in the corner of the painting here. One more kind of to fill out this. There's a lot of white space over here, so just kind of make that disappear. Even it out. There we go. There we go. Cool. All right, there's all my clouds. Again, like, doesn't take that much, like, skill to do that. Like, it's just, all you have to do is just take wet paint and just blob it on there. And it looks good. All right, let me redo that shadow under there because I'm kind of losing it. It's not as dark as I thought it was going to be, so I'm going to remix that blue and black here. There we go. Okay, and another thing I almost forgot to do is to paint the claws on our Quetzalcoatlus. So we didn't paint claws last week because they were too far away. But this week we're painting claws. Brachiosaurus had claws, but they're so far away. I'm gonna do black claws. I'm gonna ever so carefully take a little bit of black and mix it with a little tiny bit of brown. So just that it's not so flat black, and paint in the claws there. There we go. Is that Marissa DeMays? Is she on my Instagram? I think it is. I went to school with Marissa DeMays. We went to middle school and high school together. When we were in middle school, she I asked her if I could borrow a pencil, and she kindly gave me a mechanical pencil to use. And it was an accident. She didn't mean to, but she gave me the pencil so forcefully that it actually like stabbed me. And to this day, I think I have a little bit of pencil lead in my hand, or graphite. But it's okay. I forgave her. All right. There we go. All right, so I think we can move on to the shading part. We could use our graphite pencils. Speaking of mechanical pencils. But I'm not going to stab myself with this one. All right, so I'm going to start with the part with the back wing and work out from there, because that's a very dark, shadowy spot. So I'm just gonna carefully color with my pencil that whole part to be darker. And then as I move out, I make my scribbles farther apart. So the base of the scribbles are gonna be very close together, and they're gonna spread out as I move away. And that'll make it look like it's a more intense shadow to a lighter shadow. That's a little trick you can do there. All right. And then I'm going to do another shadow on top of that shadow, implying where the arm would be. So you can see that there. So now the arm on the far wing is defined. Now let's move on to the wing that's closer to us. So there's going to be a lighter shadow. I'm not going to make it too intense. Underneath the arm. Maybe a little shadow under the wrist here, under the claws. a very light shadow under the finger. I do a darker shadow on the bottom side of that finger. And then I'm going to draw some lines on the wings themselves. And these wings were supported by, like, I don't want to say tendons, but like tissue that ran from the base of the wing downward. So there was like tissue that was just running down that way. So it wouldn't have been completely smooth. If you were to like meet a pterosaur and touch its wing, it wouldn't have felt like stretchy or soft. It would have probably been pretty thick, firm. All right, there's the underside of the wing here. And a little shadow on the leg. Underside of the tail. I'm gonna do a couple little lines, little messy lines on the chest there, because the chest is white. So I don't wanna do too much with the chest. So just some light lines implying that there's fur there and there's a little bit of shadow, but I don't wanna do too much shadow, because if I do the shadow too hard on that white section, it's not gonna look so good. If I was doing a full painting, like everything painting, not pencil at all, what I would do for shadow on a white thing is use blue, a light blue. Shadow of the eye, a little bit of a shadow on the beak, underside of the beak, underside of the throat. And do more squiggle lines on the top of the neck here. And I'm going back and I'm tracing the outline because it got a little bit lost when I painted the clouds. So you can see the neck now has some, a little bit more texture. Okay. Implying that there's like furry feather like things covering it. You know what would be neat? I feel like the Jim Henson Company should totally create like a life-size puppet of a Quetzalcoatlus or another large pterosaur. I think that would be something really cool that they could pull off. If you ever watch, it's on Netflix, the show Dark Crystal, and then the movie from the 80s, the original Dark Crystal, they're capable of doing some amazing things. And I bet you they could put together a really neat Asdarchid, which is the group of pterosaurs this is, puppet. Okay. Okay, there's my shadows. And I'm gonna do a little bit of shadow on this background guy, nothing crazy. Shadow under the wing. Again, the background stuff you should absolutely include if you want to, and backgrounds are always neat and exciting, they bring a lot of life to a picture, but if you can't put too much detail, the farther back you go. All right, so there's the shading. And then on to our last step. We're going to go a little bit past 5 o'clock today. I think because I drew that second pterosaur. And the last step is going over with this nice little pen just to really bolden the lines here to make the Quetzalcoatlus that's closest to us pop. I'm not going to outline the flying Quetzalcoatlus in black ink. Because again, it's supposed to be farther away. It's not supposed to be that detailed. So not the eye I just did. I'm doing the bristles and feathers and quills or fur, whatever you want to call it. Like I said, I think the most recent scientific studies determine that this covering was a kind of feather. Before that, we didn't think they were truly feathers. We thought they were just like fuzz, pterosaur fuzz, which is interesting. Think about it, like a reptile. When you think of reptiles, you think of scales only. But if you go back in time, reptiles, which is a very broad group with a lot of variation in it, we're capable of producing a lot of different things, not just scales. In fact, since birds Dinosaurs, and dinosaurs are reptiles. Birds are actually nestled within the group reptiles as well. Although most people don't consider birds reptiles casually. Like if I say reptiles to you, you don't think of birds. You think of like a snake or a turtle, or a crocodile. But if you're going by biology and evolution, birds are considered reptiles. And to further prove that, if you look at the DNA of all the different reptiles, it's just you just say the ones that are alive today, right? I can the Instagram ended, so I can put that aside for now. If you take DNA and look at all the DNA of all the reptiles alive today, what you'll find is that the DNA of crocodiles, which is the group that includes alligators and crocodiles, which is also a diverse group by itself, is the most similar, has the most in common, and therefore the most closely related to bird DNA. So an alligator is has more in common and is more closely related to like a penguin or a chicken than it is to a lizard or a turtle or a snake. So birds certainly should be included. And pterosaurs too. Pterosaur would be another kind of reptile. They were closely related to dinosaurs, but not quite dinosaurs themselves. Okay, and the last step, here's my lovely Quetzalcoatlus, and my last step is going to be sign my name, Chris D. There it is. And there's our Quetzalcoatlus, looking good. And look how strange. Let's all appreciate how weird this animal proportions were. I did my best not to mess up. That head was truly that large, the neck was really that long, and the torso was really that small. What a weird animal, huh? All right. So I hope you enjoyed this week's activity. I hope you're not mad that it's not technically a dinosaur, but I don't think it's a problem. Pterosaurs are cool. They can be included too. We'll be back again next week with another video. And this, during this coming week until then, we're going to vote on another prehistoric animal. I think it's going to be another dinosaur this time. So stay tuned on the Field Station Dinosaurs Facebook page and check out which two dinosaurs we're going to be choosing from next. All right. See you guys. Bye-bye.